onto mute their cell phones, and this meeting is being audio and video recorded. Are there any changes or approval to the agenda? Counselor Charlton?
I'm wondering if you could add how we advertise, again, this is a question on advertising after last night's hearing.
We could add that as.
Report.
Under report. We could put that as page 15 to 16. I just put it in reports. 14.3. Discussion regarding communication. Are there any other additions? If not, I'll call for a motion to accept the agenda as amended. Counselor Gidney moves. Counselor Brown seconds. All those in favor signify by raising your hand. Carried. There are no presentations at this point in time. Are there any petitions to be tabled? Number five, public question comment session. I remind those who wish to comment to state their name and their civic address. Any public questions, comments?
Can you set it on this?
Yes.
Yes, it is. Yes, it was.
Yes, Mayor Norman, under 9.1 night council meetings, mentions in the information provided by the CAO that extra staff time cost there, says a few thousand dollars. I was wondering if we could be more precise on that at this point. And also, it would be an unbudgeted item until the end of March, is that correct?
That's true, it was not budgeted, and it just mentions a several thousand without any direct cost, because until it actually happens, the cost of that, Mr. McNeil has to determine how that would work, correct?
Sorry.
So at this point in time, you're correct, it would be a non-budgeted item, and the exact cost is not known at this time.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Any other questions, comments? Hearing none. Approval of the minutes from the regular council meeting of November 24th, 2020. Moved by Councillor Hawk, seconded by Deputy Mayor Muse. All those in favor, signify by raising your hand. Nothing to report on dangerous unsightly premises. Nothing to report from economic development. Councillor Charlton, perhaps you would like to make the motion regarding question 9, policy 23, regular meeting council.
Thank you, Mayor Norman. I move that the Council of Regional Queens Municipality approve policy 23, respecting regular meetings of council.
Seconded by Councilor Romero. Discussion. Councilor Fancy.
I think we need to bring forward what we're discussing. This is about both changing, we're changing our meeting format, right?
Okay, so for those of you who have not read the package, perhaps those in the gallery, it has been brought forward that the regular system of daytime meetings makes it difficult for working people to attend, and it's also a barrier for those who may wish to run for council in the future if they are a working person. Therefore, it's been recommended, we discussed it last week, or last meeting, gave staff the ability to look into this matter. So the decision is that every second council meeting will be an evening meeting, and that would incur, as we heard, $1,000 in lieu of extra time for those who have to attend on staff matters. So that is a discussion point. Council Brown?
I don't feel that this motion that we have on the books now will do what we want it to do. I think having every second meeting, it's not going to allow people who work through the day to attend the meetings. They're still going to have every second meeting that they won't be able to attend. We're trying to attract new people to run, and we're not having an election for 4 years, so it seems kind of, you know, if that's our intent, we're pushing it. And the councilors sitting around the table now all ran with the intention that the meetings would be on the daytime. So changing the rules now before, you know, 4 years away from an election seems a little premature, considering the added cost.
Thank you, Councilor Brown, for your comments. Councilor Charlton.
This, I brought this recommendation forward because it was about being inclusive, which has many avenues. People wishing to run for council, maybe it still will be a barrier, but I think it's a starting point, and that's what we have to remember. And literally every other municipality around us is meeting in the evening, and by doing a hybrid option, we're allowing equal opportunity. Those that can't attend in the day can attend in the evening, and those who wish to not attend in the evening can attend in the day.
Thank you. Councilor Romero.
I have to agree with Councilor Charlton. Along my travels, I have heard that as well, that people wanted to attend the meetings in the evenings. So I think this would give the option at least for everybody. Okay.
Further comments? Councilor Fancy?
It's a difficult one because, like as we were saying last meeting, places like Bridgewater, the whole bay, where you're very close at hand, it doesn't matter because of weather. If I were in the country, I'd be definitely against it. Because it's 7 o'clock at night, it could be, you know, never know what the weather's going to be like, the plowing and everything else that comes along with it. To me, being in here, closer to town, it doesn't matter. I do find it rather confusing because if you're going to have one meeting of days and the next one at night, it's kind of just confusing. I love something that's consistent. I think in my own way, I'd like to either go one way or the other. And I find a hybrid kind of it's just going to be kind of confusing in which and how you do it. As far as being, like I say, inclusive, I don't think it's inclusive, but it's including. If you want to try to include people into to be able to run for council, or maybe if they're all evening meetings, it could make it easier. Going one and then the other, I don't think it's going to change if somebody's going to be able to run or not, because they either got, now it might help somebody like a couple of our councilors here who have to rearrange their schedule more, but for somebody who was either working days, they couldn't, it wouldn't make a difference, like being 50%. So it's a little awkward, and it's going to be a little awkward for our staff. And I really don't know how it is, but like I said, if I were still living up the country, I would not want that because of the winter hours and everything else to go along with it.
Councilor Fancy, any other comments? Councilor Gidney?
I think this is a great recommendation. I think this gives the population, the residents, an opportunity to attend if they wish. They've got two in morning and evening. They can go on the website and watch a video, but it gives an opportunity. And I think that's what should be all about, is opportunities to help out. If they want to do it, fine. If they don't, that's fine too. But if the opportunity is there, it gives them that choice. Thank you.
Any other further comments?
As we had previously discussed at our last meeting in regards to the weather with the evening, I had mentioned what would happen in the daytime for our counselors that have to travel further, in which we were told that this building would close due to severe weather. So I don't feel that that is a reason why we should not move forward with this recommendation.
Before I recognize Counselor Fancy, is there anyone, Counselor Brown, would you like to?
I just wanted to respond to the evening travel. It's evening travel in the winter is a lot harder than daytime travel in the winter. And when you travel long distances, it does have a major concern. Even last night, the heavy snow squalls on the way out, it's tiring drive, especially after a long meeting. And as people get older, you know, we're talking about being more inclusive. A lot of older people have trouble driving at night. So we're including more people, more younger people by having evening meetings, but we may be eliminating older people who want to attend the meetings.
Counselor Fancy?
Yes, it does make a difference with weather. I traveled in 20 years from Caledonia to come into the mill, and you the plows are on during the day. During the night, they're always trying to get ready to get people so they can get into work. So everything is all geared around the daytime operations. So it does make a difference with plowing. The other point I was going to say here, that I find that I love consistency in it, and the idea of if we want to go to all evening meetings and we want to go that way, I would go for that. I hate the hybrid when you don't. It's like you're changing one week to the next. Which week are we doing this? And which week are we doing that? And then the staff has to adjust to that accordingly too. So I think it makes as Councilor Brown said, we've had meetings before in the evening. We tried these four during the year just to see how they would work, and we just didn't get any attendance. So attendance, I don't think, is going to be the issue. It's going to be how are we going to make it for anybody who would want to run, and I think the hybrid won't do that. And I don't think it will accomplish what we want to do. I know what Councilor Charlton is trying to do, and I think it's a great idea, but I it won't accomplish that feature, I think.
Any councilors who have not yet commented or wish to make a comment? Councilor Charlton, do you want to make the final comment?
Sure, thank you. The only thing I would like to add to that when I put this recommendation forward was that I did not ask for all the meetings to be moved to the evening because I felt like it would be more difficult for staff to adjust to that. And in planning this in a hybrid option, we know for a full year ahead when those evening meetings will be. They'll be the fourth Tuesday of every month. It's just a time change. And I felt like this was more reasonable of an ask so that the staff weren't completely turned upside down. And I think this is something we can move forward and work with, and it's a starting point. I would personally love to see maybe in the future evening meetings be a thing, as Councilor Fancy had mentioned fully, but I think we need to start somewhere, and I think that is a little too aggressive, and so that would be my reason with that, and that's my final comment.
I believe we are ready for the question. All those in favor signify by raising your hand. Contrary? Passed. And as we have changed this policy, always change policies back. Engineering Public Works, nothing on the agenda. Finance, nothing on the agenda. Recreation, Health and Communities. Planning, 13.1. Councilor Romero, both of these are in your district. So perhaps if you would read the recommendation for 13.1.
I move that Council of the Region of Queens Municipality adopt an administrative policy respecting our development agreement with the New Germany Enviro Center Incorporated to allow for the establishment of a recycling depot and processing operation on property identified as PID number 7008-3902 and located at 3965 Highway 3 in Brooklyn.
Seconded by Counselor Gibbons. So last evening, there was a public hearing on this matter. This came forward to us as a recommendation from Planning Advisory. Basically, it will be an enviro center. Everything will be inside, no outside storage, excepting for, I believe, Director McLeod on the day of pickup. But other than that, everything will be 100% contained within the building.
That's right.
And do you wish to add any further comments?
No, I think the recycling depots of old are a thing of the past. Regulations around enviro depots are considerably more stringent than they were days gone by. So this operation is intended for entirely operated within the confines of the building. So thereby reducing the impact on the surrounding properties.
And there were no negative feedbacks from anyone in the public, written or expressed?
No.
Any comments or questions? Counselor Gibney?
Just one comment. My understanding is that there may be the blue tubs, maybe outside, but no products.
It's a product that can't
right,
be,
and that's
can't
what,
be stored.
I just wanted to clarify that point, that there'd be no product, but there may be the blue tubs outside.
And I guess in the draft development agreement, I did include provision that if there was anything stored outside, it'd be screened from the public.
Right.
By way of an opaque fence or something of that,
yes.
That nature.
Yes.
Other comments from councilors?
I think it's a wonderful opportunity for a community. It's especially the electronics that are going to accept those as well. And being in the paint business myself, for somebody to be able to go in and get some of the leftover paint for free,
mm-hmm.
and it doesn't have to go to the landfill,
mm-hmm.
I think it's fabulous, actually.
Good point. I believe we're ready for the questions. Oh, Councilor Fancy, did you have a comment?
I could have said the same thing she was saying.
Okay.
the 2 points that I got.
I believe we're ready for the question. All those in favor, signify by raising your hand. Contrary, you pass. And Councilor Romero, 13.2.
I move that the Council of Regional Queens Municipality adopt an administrative policy respecting a development agreement with Century Limited Investments Limited to allow for the establishment of a beverage formulation, testing, and small-scale production operation on the property identified as PID number 7009-3653 and located at 412 East Berlin Road in East Berlin.
Seconded by Councilor Fox. Again, this matter was brought to a public hearing last evening in Seaside Center in Beach Meadows. I believe one of the only questions raised was the amount of traffic, and the question was answered by there would be no extremely large truck traffic, just some small for delivery. This is a small operation, continuation of an existing business located elsewhere in the country. The owner has relocated to East Berlin and wishes to resume his operation here. Small scale, non-alcoholic beverages. Director McLeod, would you like to add anything?
No, that's certainly pretty much it. Now, we did include a number of conditions within the development agreements, looking at on-site parking, any lighting being directed away, and the outdoor storage being screened, similar to the previous development agreement. So I think adequate provision is certainly within the development agreement to reduce impact on the surrounding residential properties.
Thank you. Councilor Brown, you had a question?
Yes. Somebody asked last night about alcoholic beverages. Would this their agreement allow them to transition into alcoholic beverage production, or would that would that fall under a different development agreement?
It's just, I guess the agreement itself is silent on that, and I know the applicant is here, and I would say it's not his intention at the present time to look at alcoholic beverages, but it's, I guess, his process that he'd be looking at if he were to go down that road would be a little different than a brewery or a distillery. I don't know whether, Ron, you wanted to comment on that?
Yes, I'm happy to.
Would you like to step forward to the mic?
Sure, thank you. If in the future there was an opportunity to produce alcoholic containing beverages, they would be beverages that would be low in alcohol content, and we wouldn't be distilling the alcohol on site, we would be bringing it in as green spirits, and then using it as an ingredient in beverages.
Thank you.
Any other comments or questions? If not, I'll ask for the question. All those in favor? Contrary? Passed. The last item on our agenda regards a road renaming, 13.3. In the LaBelle area, there's a small road called Mill Road or Mill Lane, and it, at one point in time, it dead ended to a lake, and decades ago, a further development was made off the extension of that road, and the new road had been called Pomock Shore Road, and it was the residents on that road find it difficult with civic numbering, emergency response, and other matters to be found, because basically someone finding them has to go to Mill Road first and then off Pomock Shore Road. So they have requested a change of name to Old Mill Lane to Pomock Shore Road, so it's one continuous road, and there's presently no occupants living on the Old Mill, on the Old Mill Road. So there is a recommendation in your package, Councillor Brown.
The recommendation that the Council of Region of Queens Municipality approve the renaming of Old Mill Lane in LaBelle to Pomock Shore Road.
Seconded by Councillor Charles. Dr. McLeod?
Yeah, just one minor note that this Old Mill Lane currently, as are, I guess, most of the roads, these are all private roads in the LaBelle area. These roads are actually owned by the Greater Malina Lake Lot Owners Association. They're owned and maintained, and it is the association that's requesting this name change so that Pomock Shore Road is contiguous out to the LaBelle Road.
Any questions or comments? Councillor Muse.
Said in here somewhere, said that if there's no one name change of the road, they must be submitted by the owner of the road. However, no specific owner can be determined. The petition signed by 70% of the persons that own the land. I don't see any people that own the land signed this.
No, because it's owned by the Greater Malina Lake Lot Owners Association. You know who the owner of the road is?
Oh, okay. There you go.
So in cases where an owner of the road is not known, then the property owners that want that road can sign a petition as long as they're 70%. So, but in this case, we do know who the owner is.
Answer your question, Councillor Brown?
Yes, when the association was looking at these roads renaming, I think a lot of it came up. There was one called Hardwood Ridge Road that was named in error, that was part of Pomock Shore Road. And at one point, the road had this one circular road had three different names on it in three different sections, and two of them were in error. All the civic numbers that run along Old Mill Lane are listed as Pomock Shore Road in their deeds. So it makes more sense to get the names agreeing with our deeds and for 911 emergency calling civic number.
Any other comments? I'll ask for the question. All those in favor, signify by raising your hand. Contrary. Fourteen point one. Catherine, information, report. So as you know, these are all the motions that have been made and yet have some matters still standing on them. Are there any questions regarding any of them? Any questions regarding any of them? If not, 14.2, Councilor Charlton wishes to have a discussion on council audio options.
Thank you, Mayor. I know there was some discussion about reworking the council chambers, and there's a huge barrier with the audio currently. And I know that some of these things will have to come in at budget time. Just wondering what we can prepare. CAO had mentioned about possibly a consultant to figure out how this room would work best in the audio as our IT, that's out of his realm, rather say. So I'm just wondering, I guess, how we can move forward with that, and if there's anything that we can do temporarily that could improve the quality, because you cannot hear the audio recordings online whatsoever. And it's been a huge problem. I've been getting a lot of complaints from constituents because they've started to interact. They like the streaming, they can see things. But last week we had that technical error and it stopped working. And then they tried to listen to the audio recording and they couldn't hear. So it's resolved in disappointment, and people are engaged and want to engage more. And so we need to allow them to be able to hear what's happening at our council meeting.
I have spoken to the CAO about this because we have had some informal discussion. In order to make this room audio, video friendly, we need to invest money. For the past many years, this has been patchwork. And to continue to patchwork it, which would be, in your terms, temporarily, it would be a temporary patch. And that's more, in my opinion, just more temporary patch monies. It is a major expenditure. It would require budget deliberation. We could probably, estimately, Mr. McNeil be looking at $35,000-$40,000, roughly.
And it's really going to depend on the nature of it. And so I would suggest to council, if we're going to do it, we do it right the first time. And we don't do it for today, we do it for the next 5, 10, 20 years, which is going to require video screens at each desk. It's going to require microphones at each desk. It doesn't matter where we put the microphones. Right now we're maxed out. The number of microphones we have hanging is the most that will fit in our receiver, whatever the terminology is. We're using an iPhone 4 to audio record it. And video recorded, and it's in one location. And so it picks up where you're at that particular time. It doesn't pick up in the rest of the room. We put a temporary microphone in for the public gallery. And so if we're going to do this, and so it's very awkward in here proceeding right now with COVID-19. And so before we do anything, we've got to decide what the final design is going to be and what components are going to be. Are we going to put video screens at each desk? Is this going to be the configuration that we have now as far as where the seating is, other than some minor adjustments after COVID? All those things have to be factored in and costed out, and that's why the original discussion was we need to go to an RFP initially to hire somebody to tell us what we need. Because if we just go to tender, we don't know what we're going to tender, because every company offers a different product. We need independent advice to tell us what the options are, and what that needs to look like for 2 years, 5 years, and 10 years down the road. As I'm sure you're all aware, technology changes, and 6 months down the road, what you just bought is outdated. And so we need to plan for that and not just simply do that. Even the electrical wiring in here it needs to be all upgraded. The speakers need to be upgraded. So the mayor suggested $35,000 to $40,000. That would be the minimum, but we're probably looking at $10,000 at least to do the RFP, to hire somebody first to do that study for us. And then you're at least $35,000-$40,000, and you're probably over $50,000 by it is a complicated issue, and I think the first issue for council, though, that Councilor Charlton's question is what does council believe this council chamber should look like as far as audiovisual going forward? And should it be independent seats as you see now? Should it be screens on your desk? Should it be microphones at each desk? We have one projector screen at the back. Most now don't have that. They have large TV screens in multiple places in the room. So one for the public gallery, one for other people in here to see. And so what does that look like for council? And so once we have an understanding of that, then we can put together potentially an RFP. Whether we do that now or at budget time is a decision of council.
Other comments or questions? Councilor Fancy?
I think that what Mr. McNeil is saying is right. We don't even know what we want yet, because that's the whole idea. And what's the configuration going to be? I think it was Councilor Charlton bringing this up. It's saying to us, we want to do something. That's the thing that we've done in the past with the council said, yes, we need to do something, and we just go year after year saying we want to do something, we need to do something, things aren't right. So we really want to, so it's a matter of budgeting, but not knowing what we need to budget. Do we want to, I know some places have individual buttons on the desk, do we need that, or do we want that? And what do we want to make this here? Is, I always say, is this going to be the permanent location for our chambers for the years to come? We have to have a complete discussion of everything before we do things, not budget it up, but planning with the idea that we will have better communication. Because like I said, again, right now, even with that up there, you can only see so much, you can only hear so much. So it would be frustrating for anybody else coming in or listening to even understand what's going on here.
Any other comments? Councilor Brown?
I think we have to move forward with this. Like Councilor Charlton said, we want to engage people. We want to give them the opportunity to follow in. I don't know if, do we have to budget for an RFP? Is that an issue that has to be on the budget?
Mayor Norman, so two options. So you can either, council can approve it in the next month or two. It obviously becomes an unbudgeted expenditure or a withdrawal from reserves. And then the same for the, I would suggest that we wouldn't get the work done before the end of March anyway, so the actual cost to do the work would be next budget year.
So we could ask for a proposal and then work towards budgeting for the work itself?
We could, yes.
Yes, okay.
Any other comments? So, I do believe that there is consensus that we do need to make our meetings more user-friendly for those who are unable to be here. The question is, if there is an RFP issued at this point in time, then as our clerk, our CAO has stated, it would remain until everything is in line in this place. Deputy Muse, would you take the chair for this for the last minute? I personally am not in favor of using any reserve money at this point in time. $10,000 is $10,000. I would rather wait until budget time when we have our entire budget in front of us. We have all expressed things that you would like to see in your districts. $10,000 becomes $50,000 and $60,000. To do an RFP for $10,000 and then perhaps at budget time realize that that's an extraordinary cost doesn't make sense to myself. I would rather wait until we get the full financial picture placed in front of us, so we realize what every nickel means on a tax rate before we proceed. I know we're escalating quickly ahead in time. 2000 doesn't seem long ago to me when I first came to council as the counselor. There were no recordings available for public, and yes, I know that was 20 years ago. there are paper minutes, and people do have the ability to attend council if they so wish, if they are not working. So I would prefer that as a council, we wait until budget, and then by that point in time, this room will be realigned, this thing will be dropped down, we'll know where all the little holes go in the floor, and we'll be able to hook up with excellent audio recording materials that will carry us through the next decade. Until that point in time, I believe it does not make sense to issue an RFP for something when we don't know what it's going to look like in here, and we're uncertain of what our costs and expenditures are going to be for next year. And I'm not in favor of taking reserve money at this point in time to do that. You have to maintain that.
Do you have any discussions on the audio options? Councilman Chapman, do you want to?
Like Councilor Brown had mentioned, had asked if we could incorporate this into the budget, and Mr. McNeil said we could do that. So I just am trying to be proactive, because I know all this stuff takes time, these studies take time. If we have, in my opinion, we have to spend that $10,000 anyways. We're doing the community a huge disservice by they're not able to know what's happening in this chamber. So it was just from a proactive point, if it makes more sense to wait a few months, and that's the consensus, then I will absolutely support that.
Anyone else?
So the consensus is we'll wait and make this a full budget matter, at which time we'll,
yeah,
and that discussion will start within 7-8 weeks.
January.
So. And Councillor Charlton, communication specifically regarding advertising, I believe.
Yes. It was apparent to me last night at the public hearing, most of the folks that were there arrived because they found out about it last minute, but they didn't really know what was happening, and they were upset that they weren't aware. So I know we had discussed last night about Lighthouse Now, so how are we currently letting the public know about our hearings and advertising in general?
Director McLeod, do you want to answer that question regarding the advertising of public hearings?
Sure. I guess for these, any planning related processes, it's regulated, the advertising is regulated under the Municipal Government Act. And right now, the Act, I guess, is a little outdated. It does specifically identify that public notices for public hearings be advertised in a newspaper, so it's specific to a newspaper circulating in the municipality. So I know the comment was brought up last night about the South Shore Breaker, but legally I think the South Shore Breaker is a flyer as opposed to an official newspaper. So technically, if somebody wanted to get technical and appeal a decision that the that they disagreed with regarding a planning amendment or a development agreement. I guess under specifics of the provincial legislation, that may be a violation of that if we were to advertise strictly in the South Shore Breaker. I know that is a good avenue because it does get to every household, but technically it's not a newspaper. So I think we can probably do more as far as notification online through the website and social media. So I think that's something we should look at. But to be in line with the Act, we are required to do a newspaper notification. So Chronicle Herald, I'm not sure if Chronicle Herald gets this it's similar, and I guess that's, I guess, the most local paper that we have, circulated in our municipality right now, so. But newsprint is, it's getting less and less every year, so, but the act still hasn't been updated to change that, so.
Yes, we could, put it forth maybe on our, the front of our Facebook page, our homepage, instead of having to go for it through the minutes. Maybe that would be easier to catch more attention, of the public hearings.
You meant, webpage?
Yes. Yes, sorry.
The website?
Yes.
Yes.
Can I just make a comment? We have to remember, we're a government. We're not a social enterprise. We're not a social body. And so we have legislative requirements for advertising. And so when we advertise, all of our legal stuff and all of our regular operational stuff is on our website. And so when we put notices on there, they often go to the front page, but then we get three or four more requests, and within a day or two, that what's on the front page now is not on the front page anymore because of the listing goes on. And we continue to get people, well, why don't you put, like last night, why don't you put it in the social breaker? We could, but there's a cost to that, and it's not illegal advertising for us, as Mr. McLeod said. We get requests put on the radio. We have two radio stations. We could certainly put on the radio, but you're into another $1,000 or $2,000 to do that. And we could put it on in other places as well. We've had requests put it at the post offices, put up signs at the post offices. And so there's a cost to doing those types of things. And so I don't want to, while I recognize it's important to keep our public aware, there's also significant costs and time involved with doing all these types of things. And everyone we talk to wants something different. And so there's no consistency throughout our residents as far as how we go about advertising and communicating the different things. We also have to recognize there is a responsibility of our citizens if they're interested in issues to keep an eye on. So for instance, the issues that were discussed last night were discussed at PAC 6 weeks ago, 8 weeks ago. The minutes are all available. The meetings are open to the public. They were discussed at council a month and a half ago. Those meetings are all online or on the audio video. The minutes are available online. The meetings are open to the public. Last night, the same way, advertised a newspaper twice, I believe. It's also advertised on our website and all those types of things. So those types of things, if people aren't aware, I'm not sure what we can do, because they are out there, we are having discussions, and there is some responsibility on our citizens to make sure if they're involved or they want to know what's going on, to keep aware of things as well. And so it is a difficult process, it is a difficult thing, and our newsletter only goes out a couple times a year. And so that's really not a good avenue, because these are all very timely things to do it, so the newsletter isn't an avenue to do that. So there are, as I said, there are lots of options, but they all, doesn't matter where we put it, we get complaints from the public, they don't know about it, and it's unfortunate, but we do the best we can with the resources we have. But my initial comment was about, we need to separate the social part of what we do for operations versus the legal and the operational part of it. So on our website, we don't put that we're putting a flag raising today, typically. We may on occasion, but we don't put that the offices, there's things going on. Those are the legislative legal parts, versus the social part, the Facebook, we put that we're doing an event or we're doing something, we're doing A, B, or C. There's a very clear line between what we post on both of them. We don't cross-contaminate. And even if on Facebook, we put it on Facebook, within a half hour, or within half a day, that post is gone, because there's 10 other posts on there if we start posting all these things on there. And so the public still aren't going to see them on there. And so we need to, if people have questions, they need to be aware. For any of the legal stuff that we do, like public hearings, they always need to look at our website, look at our agendas and our minutes and those types of things.
And if I might add, the cost of the advertising and the cost it takes us, that's the cost to the proponent.
That's correct.
So the more we advertise to let the public be aware of things that they can find if they are watching us through our minutes, the more it costs the proponent. And if you speak to any proponents now, there is a cost to these public hearings and development agreements that they wish. So if we, the more advertising, the stiffer the cost is going to be for anyone wishing to enter into development agreements. Councilor Charlton.
Thank you, Mayor Norman. I'm just wondering, as Mr. McLeod mentioned, that the Lighthouse Now, or the app rather, is a bit outdated, but the Lighthouse Now is a subscription-based, so currently people that are getting that notification are privileged to get a newspaper. There are many here that are not. So I'm wondering, you know, in regards to like the radio and things like that, come with huge costs, why could we not look at doing an email list? So we're not, I understand that we have to adhere to like the paper, which puts us to Lighthouse Now, so we have to do that, but I think that we can do a better job of getting the word out about things that are happening within our municipality.
Okay, so that is a bigger discussion that we've had informally before about contracting email addresses for all our citizens and everyone that owns land within the region of Queens. And it's a daunting task, but I believe it's one that is not impossible to do. Recognizing that people will change their email addresses as often as they change whatever sometimes. The whole privacy aspect of email addresses, for example, we cannot just go through email addresses that we have on file and send people blanket email addresses because of the Privacy Act of Canada. We would have to somehow contact them first, request an email address from them, and then they would have to check and sign that they consent to us sending them information. So that itself is another one of those processes that we would have to decide that's important for us to have. And then our CAO would have to assign staff over a certain amount of time to gather that information. It would be valuable to have. It's difficult to obtain, but not impossible.
So just if I may, just to give you an example. So we have a water utility which has 1,300 customers. Wouldn't it be great if we had a list of 1,300 email addresses or phone numbers? We could text message if there's going to be, if there's a water main break or whatever. The cost and time to do that is enormous. We have a couple hundred businesses and we have an email list for that, and it never works. They bounce back all the time. We ask people to be on the list. They reject us, or they say, no, we're not interested. We don't want you on your mailing list. And so we have a half business list because we can't keep it up to date. They keep coming back. And when it gets rejected, we don't necessarily know who it is. It might be ABC company, and we have no idea who ABC company is because it's not the formal name of the company. And so then we have to go back through all of our old records, or we don't know who they are, to contact and update it. And we have a lot of people who just refuse to be on our mailing lists. They just don't wish to be. It's no different than flyers. We talked about social breaker. There's lots of people that don't get flyers because they're on a no flyer list. So that doesn't cover anybody either. So there's lots of things. So even the Recycle app, it's a free app where people can get notifications about their waste. We'll have a discussion this afternoon about solid waste issues, but I think you'll find there's probably maybe a few hundred people on it, 400 or 500 people of 6,000 dwellings. So even that, which is free, which is easy, which is very helpful, and you go in and use it yourself, you don't necessarily need to get the notifications. We still can't get buy-in for that. But the provisions around privacy are significant, and so people have to check the box that they agree to it. We have to keep sending it to them every year, get them to reapply or get to agree every year, I believe. The time consuming, so we don't even have the resources to do a water utility, let alone to do 6,000 or really 15,000 tax accounts to let all the taxpayers know of hearings that are going on. So it's a monumentous task, although it's we'd love to do it. The cost and the time is significant.
Councilor Fancy.
Queens Care Society put out a document back probably 3 or 4 years ago, and they were, I forget what it was all about at the particular time, but they were looking how we can communicate with the seniors in particular. And then, and I think it was, and I forget how it went about, but the number one on the list of things that the seniors look at is the breaker. Now, there may be people who do not use the breaker, but on their list, using something where somebody has already done the homework to it, it shows forward that a lot of people use the breaker, read the breaker. So it's something that they will go into and look at. And it was, I mean, it's not what I'm saying, it's what the survey did, that they found that that's what people do, because we don't have a paper. So that's the most common one we use, the paper. I mean, hopefully, somewhere along the way, we're going to get something using the information we have, I think is a good avenue to go toward, at least that you get the majority of the people.
Councilor Brown?
In regards to the breaker, I live in LaBelle, and with municipal matters, different things that come out, they base their number that they ship to the post office to go in those boxes or for flyers on the number of full-time residents. So in the summer, they'll send out 75 copies of something, but there's 400 people out there in the summer, so the first 75 people there get their copies. I haven't seen a flyer out there for over a year. Just as an example, that the breaker is a great option, but it's not great everywhere. I think we have to have an integrated approach if we're going to do something. So.
Other comments? So our CAO is, his advice from what I interpret, is we have to make our residents aware that we're not a social enterprising unit, we are a government. And as a government, we have our venues through which our citizens should keep contact through us. And that is mainly our website.
And if I may, and so a lot of councillors have Facebook sites, a lot of councillors have other, your own mailing lists and stuff, so there's nothing to prevent you if you get the copy of the agenda from posting it on your individual Facebook site to let the residents, especially if the hearing's in your district, or the notices in your district or someone affects your residence or your property, so let them know. There's nothing to prevent you from doing that, or to forward or repost the website on your on email list that you may have and those types of things. We just can't do it. And while I recognize a lot of people say post on Facebook, we get as many complaints about people complaining that we post on Facebook as we do of those that we don't post on Facebook. And as I said, when we post on Facebook, it just disappears after later in the day, because of all the other posts that go on Facebook. But so it doesn't prevent members of council from reposting and distributing all this stuff from their own lists.
Just one comment. I did look for the public hearing on our website, and I do disagree that things like public hearings, we don't have a lot of them, and I knew it had to be there somewhere, that I knew it just had to be. So I found it in under the council button and then under council agendas, and it was listed with like a lot of them, and I specifically knew what I was looking for. So if I had not been specifically looking to find that, I am very doubtful if I would have found it, because it was just and public hearings, 2 a month maybe our maximum, and they are the ones that people are interested in, especially in their own neighborhood. So perhaps Mr. McNeil, talk to, and I know I realized we just had that site redesigned, but if there was a way that there could be, when you enter that home page, simply some type of alert that lets people aware that there's a public hearing coming up. Because it is, you do have to be consciously looking to find something. It's not like you're reading a newspaper and it's there. It's, you know, and I thought, is it an event? No, it had to be council. So then, you know, you go to council, and then it's all the audio things, and then you have to keep looking down and down, and then I finally found it, and I knew it was there. So I do recognize people's frustration, but then again, many people said to me, well, I never look at your website. So, you know, our website is our information tool. That is our main tool, is the Region of Queens website.
And I will say, staff will be bringing forward a proposal in a couple of months about how to deal with a lot of this stuff, which will be part of the whole discussion about our plans over the next 4 years. And so there will be a proposal to help, which may, It won't, as I said, everybody's got a different viewpoint as to what we need to do, but there will be a proposal come forward that hopefully will streamline all this and make more sense than what we're doing today.
And thank you, Counselor Amaro, for posting that on your Facebook page. Personally, I don't post the Region of Queens business matters, because then I think if I forget something someday, then I'm going to get hung because I didn't put it on there. You know, I tend to post social things because Facebook is a social site. But I think perhaps after hearing last night's comments that I, you know, and then you forget something and Councilor Brown.
I'd just like to add, with Councilor Romero put it on Facebook, and we did see the posting for it, but the way Facebook works, we went to go back and search for it again last night and couldn't find it because she had shared something and it doesn't show up on your feed again. You can't search somebody's feed for something that they've shared. You have to know who the original poster was. And so it goes back to what Mr. McNeil said, that sometimes things disappear, and if we count on them, we have to be careful what we count on, because things can disappear on us.
Councilor Fancy, and then I think we're almost finished.
Okay, and the other thing is, we understand that probably a third of the people don't use Facebook. So that's not even gonna reach them or touch them, because they just don't go there. So we have to have a paper route of the paper.
Anyway, we'll look forward to hearing plans. I know once upon a time a PAC, a member, suggested that in their municipal unit, when there were development agreements or development applications on certain parcels of land, there was a certain type of large signage of a certain color that was placed on that property. So when people drove by it, they would recognize that that meant something was happening on that piece of land. We'll wait and hear staff's report on what's coming forward. So, we'll wait for that one.
May I add a closing comment on that? Is there anything that we're expecting from the staff proposal, Mr. McNeil, that would not be wise for us to maybe explore, like the breaker? As Councilor Fancy said, not everyone is on Facebook, but not everyone is paying for a subscription for a newspaper either, and that for anyone that's willingly accepting flyers, a breaker comes in. So is there anything stopping us currently from exploring utilizing that as well when it comes to public hearings specifically?
No, I would suggest that we wait until council has an education session on the communications, what we do and what we don't do now.
Okay.
And then I think you'll more fully understand, as I'm trying to articulate, but not very well here today, I don't think, about what we do on Facebook, what we do on Twitter, what we do on our website, what we do in the newsletter, and try to articulate all those differences. And then I think it'll be clear as far as the what approach we need to take, which may include the break.
Okay, thank you.
Anything else? A motion to move in camera. Moved by Councilor Gibney, seconded by Councilor Brown. Moving camera, we'll just have a short 5-7 minute recess. We'll resume that. Vote on the motion to move in camera. Contrary?
There's no contrary.
Moved by Councilor Gideon, we move over camera. It is seconded by Councilor Brown. All those in favor? Contrary? Passed. Councilor Amaro, you're busy today.
I move that the Region of Queens Municipality agrees to grant a quick claim deed to Robert Dexter for any interest that the municipality may have in property identified as PID number 7024387, and that this transaction be subject to Robert Dexter becoming owner of adjacent parcel identified as PID number 7008819 or a portion thereof, and that all costs incurred in this transaction be borne by Robert Dexter.
Seconded by Councilor Gibney. Director McLeod.
Yep, that's as per the Municipal Government Act, council certainly does have this ability to convey a parcel that's of insufficient size to be reasonably developed. That our solicitor and land registration office has noted that they don't feel that the municipality does own this this parcel of land, so quick claim deed would be conveying any interest that we may have in the parcel.
Thank you. Questions, comments? All those in favor, signify by raising your hand. Contrary. And that is our last item on our agenda. Thank you all. And see you at our next council meeting.